As I need to see the pictures, I'm standing with my back to you. And I will tell a story about Rembrandt arriving in Amsterdam as a portrait painter. 50 years ago, I identified this portrait of Andries de Graaf from documents and found new documents with it. And the only problem I had with this portrait, besides the identification I was sure of, were the clothing, because he has no hand cuffs and the collar is rather simple, like the Calvinists were wearing at the time. And one thing I know for sure, that this man was not from a Calvinistic family, because Amsterdam was not a Calvinistic stronghold, not at all, only during the Civil War, when the Pauw family was in power. And so it took years till 2006 that we found out what was happening with this costume, but at first sight it seems very Calvinistic. The problem was in 91, when we had a big exhibition in Berlin, Amsterdam and London. The portrait was identified as Cornelis Witsen because his face was the same as the two I see show you to the right side. But what you can see clearly, and was to be seen then as well, is that the man, Cornelis Witsen, had black hair and is not a blonde dandy. Which is rather important. And I had found, 50 years ago, these two portraits by Flink and Qualinus. And you see, 10 years later, he was balding. And in 61, at his 50th birthday, he was wearing the first dateable wig in Amsterdam. So we made progress. To understand a bit what was going on in the Protestantiate in Amsterdam, I compare him with his older brother, Cornelis de Graaf. And you see, his brother is wearing the new folk of cloth. I'm afraid I'm missing the word, but he was dressed differently. He is wearing cuffs and lace collar, and he is still not. But at that moment, we didn't know it. The new portrait here, I show you, is also a Protestantiate portrait of very great importance. And there was a problem with the status of these three problems. And when we were looking at these portraits, I came across recently that we know from the documents from 39 that he was not content with the picture. So the price was lowered to 500 guilders, and it might have been originally 1,000 guilders. And that had to do, when I turn back, to the background in his brother's portrait. Was in Marie's portrait, and Marieke de Winkel found out about 2005, I think, that Andries de Graaf was in mourning. That was why he had no lace collar and no cuffs, no gold and no diamonds. This portrait in the exhibition shows a little boy from 30 months old in mourning, in black dress, black cap, no diamonds, no gold. And when we look carefully, we see the small ring he's wearing is a gold ring, but wound with black thread while he's in mourning. Here he is wearing his gold chain, and when you look carefully at it at the exhibition, you see it is wrapped up, and you see the gold coming through. And I remember 60 years ago, my father, at the funeral of his mother, in military dress, fur cape
and all the feathers on his hat had this ding dong dong all wrapped up in black, which was old fashioned at the time. So it is a very old habit, and you have to know about these habits to understand portraits, to identify them. So I was discussing that he was not content with the portrait, and when you see the portrait of his brother, you see new modern black tiles very precisely and modern architecture in the background. The same is true in the portrait of Gerard Reinst and even of Margaretha Vos, who is in the exhibition. So there we have the leading fashion in the city among the reigning families. Andries de Graaf is standing in front of the house. You see the tiles inside the door. This is a 16th century door. And that was not what was the habit. So there had to be a price lowering necessary. And when you look well, this is historical painting, as we see in the Visitation. Here you see a kind of architecture like that, but you see still Rembrandt was not a portrait painter to do the whole thing the right way. And all the paintings we come across now, we see that it is not modern interior because he was not interested in it. He was born in Leiden and brought up in a very small house at the outskirts of the city. Here we have a cutout. This is a new map from 1600 by Pieter Bast. And you can see that those are the small houses you have everywhere at the city walls. Here at the city walls you have the smaller houses. And here are a little bit bigger houses. And it was in a house like that, that Lievens lived. And then I go back the right way, yes. Lievens was living in a larger shop house here. And Rembrandt in a small house. So he had no much place, lower ceiling. The first work of him was rather small. Now I got. He came to Amsterdam. And that was the first job he got with Uilenburg. In 1991, I wrote, Rembrandt found work in Amsterdam, and the whole Rembrandt research project went against it, and that sentence, small sentence, was taken out of the book because that was not true, because Ernst had made the Uilenburg shop the first shop of Rembrandt in Amsterdam. Here you see clearly that the house here had, this is a modern house from 1606 with larger windows, higher floors, and on the north side. The house from Uilenburg is here, is this wall part of the house, and there was much place to work in. As he had never painted a portrait, and he was asked to come to Amsterdam by Uilenburg to paint an anatomical lesson of Dr. Tulp, he had to paint some male portraits, and so his first portraits were painted without effort before he started to paint. Just after finishing the anatomical lesson by Tulp, he went to The Hague, probably to paint a commission he had got also in the summer of 1631, but by the time he arrived in The Hague, Amalia van Solms was heavily pregnant and had a daughter in April, and so this portrait of Amalia, which is not very well preserved, was painted around the delivering of the girl, but even on his way to The Hague, he painted in Leiden his sister in the fashion that he was asked to paint Amalia van Solms. So even there he had tryouts to paint her. I give you a problem. The problem Rembrandt had Rembrandt had never seen a lace collar at that time. They had and the first one to wear was the Princess of Orange, the first lady of the country, and that was a fine needle point from Italy, and she's wearing it in three layers, 1, 2, and 3. And never having seen such a collar, he tried it out with thread by thread, and you see, he had done it thread by thread, but when you see it from some distance, it is blurred here and does not work as an official portrait for the Gallery of Honor. So it was never placed next to her husband. This is Molotov. This is the anatomical lesson he painted, and you see, he did not follow the old lines of portraits, but had a concentration on the lesson as a wonder of God by Dr. Taube. And here he changed portraiture overwhelmingly. There you see the first proof that he was not a portrait painter from origin. These are portraits he painted also in The Hague, and here it is important to mention that the portrait of Johanna van Krooswijk was finished, must have been finished by his pupil Isaac de Jureville, who had followed Rembrandt to Amsterdam and stayed during the years that Rembrandt was in Amsterdam with him. In Amsterdam, he painted the Rijksen family, the son, who is on exhibition, and the parents, who are now at Buckingham Palace, and that was the famous shipbuilder, Jan Rijksen, living in a brand new house where they built the big ships for the East Indian Company. But Rembrandt did not paint a brand new house. He made it also, turned it in an historical painting by presenting the letter by his wife and not sitting next to each other, which was also a breach with tradition. Here, Uilenburg had demanded Frans Hals to come to Amsterdam to pay the citizens of his neighborhood in a military peace. And just as he asked Rembrandt to come to Amsterdam, made clear at the time that there were not enough portrait painters of quality in Amsterdam, so that by the time that Rembrandt started in Amsterdam, it was clear that Uilenburg had to look out for good painters from elsewhere. So, for instance, Abraham de Vries came from Antwerp to Amsterdam, Jacob Bakker from Frisia to Amsterdam to paint for the Orphans Chamber, and also Frans Hals was came to see the lace collars for the first time here and here at the Youngsters in Amsterdam, and he had no experience with it, and painted three small paintings which are not full-size portraits to master the lace in different forms. And those people are named, and the middle one of them, Albert Nachtglas, has been a painter as well. So he might have known Rembrandt. At the same year, Rembrandt left Amsterdam again and went to Leiden for the summer and painted relatives of his mother. This is the baker Willem Burggraaf, married to a member of the extended family of Rembrandt's mother. And so, in my mind, because having no assistance in Leiden, Rembrandt painted this painting himself and was also trying out the lace collar for the first time. And then
he crushed in here with a reed pen or something else, the lace, but he did see that it did not work. So he started working at this lop. He took over to paint black in white, the lace, as you see it developing on the lace collar, and this became his style. But no one else could have done so in Leiden, because Rembrandt was only back for a short time in his old workshop. So I think we have to think this painting as an important early portrait with lace by Rembrandt. This is a very new painting in the Rembrandt oeuvre, and here we see the lace, I think 34, because here you see that the lace is filled up all over the shoulder, where we have a white, when I go back here, you have a white part, and this is a development in luxury to have more lace and more expensive or cheaper lace in the collar. So I see this as a bridegroom, probably, part of a larger painting where a lady was sitting around here. You see parts of it over here. And also you see the lace was worked in the sleeves, which was exactly at the time you see at the large portrait of Sandfort in the exhibition. You see the same working, but here it is more refined, and probably this is British fashion, but I don't know for sure, because Dirk de Graaf was wearing it already in 1630. So the lace was the special fashion of a short time between 32 till 35, 6, and then it moves on in different forms. So it is very clearly to date. The only thing is that we have to identify the man, but I have not found and will not find time to identify him, I'm sorry. Here, detail of the collar, just as we saw with Amalia van Solms. And here you see that when Frans Hals went back to Haarlem to start a new commission, he left the setup piece in the studio for years. And that's the moment that Rembrandt looked carefully at the military piece and took Nicolas Bombeek, him, and looked very carefully at him for Martin Solmans as a bridegroom. He married on the 23rd of June in the new church in Amsterdam, commissioned the painting, and that was just after Frans Hals had set up this painting in the studio. Here too you see very large lace collar, only the white here is still there, and not like in the painting of the new painting, where this is covered with lace as well. I think the new painting is a little bit later than that one in fashion. And the thing is that this painting was finished in 1633, coincidence with the dating of the new painting. Here I show you my first identification of the collar in mourning. You see that the collar was more white, larger, and that is a reason to recognize him. And here I come to a point to have a look. Same hairdresser, same painter. For me,
the hair of Hendricks de Graaf was a reminder immediately to his hair, but you may disagree. But for me, the situation is that I say you have to look in Rembrandt, in the Uilenburg studio for these portraits. I need to come to an end. This is another two portraits that were denied a place in the Rembrandt oeuvre and were given back to Rembrandt because the signature here, well, the date was cut off. And because this hat of Pelikon was the same kind of portrait as Dr. Nicolas Tulp, it was dated 1632. But there I had a problem. The boy, who is painted by Jureville, is not wearing a boy's dress, but he wears trousers. And that means that the boy is 6 years old. And as he was baptized in July 1628, the portrait must have dated from 1634. And then we come to the right moment. And that was the moment that Rembrandt had married Saskia and had decided to stop portrait painting and starting his own workshop. And this portrait of Anthony Coppel, which in general is placed in Uilenburg studio, I think, as is the brother in the new family of Rembrandt's wife, that this one was painted in the new workshop in the Doelenstraat. And especially because it shows the special interest of Rembrandt in light and dark and shade. I think this is from his own workshop and not an official portrait. Two more. In 1633, the Rembrandtsters, the old Dutch Protestants who were thrown out of that church, tried to reorganize that church in a large congress during the month of April in Amsterdam. Uitenbogen, their leader, was there, and also one of the people he lived with in Rotterdam, Jacob Kouwenhove. They were both at a congregation where it was decided to have the new school for teachers in Amsterdam. The professor was one of the extended family, as you can see here. In 1634, the Rembrandt went again to out of the workshop after his marriage and went to Rotterdam to paint the matriarch of the Pessel family in Rotterdam. You see Kouwenhove over there and his wife, and that's why his date of his painting was already painted the year before. And I want to end with these. Ernst published the portrait of Isaac de Jureville as a girl in 1983, and I told him that this was not a haircut, the haircut or hairdresser again, for girls. Girls had their hair in a bun, and this is a boy, and a very young boy who was asked to paint his own portrait after the example of Rembrandt, and they both went to the workshop of Uilenburg and stayed there. And only in 1734, Govert Flink came to the workshop of Uilenburg. And these things were known in the dissertation of Ernst van der Wetering, and I think he should have concluded that only the name of Jureville and Govert Flink at the end were the possible workers in the workshop and no other ones. No names turned up during my 50 years of research. And that, I think, is important to take in mind.